As a young girl growing up in Venice Beach, California, she had many nicknames. She was variously known to her friends and family as Casper, Lil Bit, Vanilla Child, and Lil Smokey. Her parents originally named her Mary Christine Brocker. The world came to know her as Lady T. This is Being Tina Marie.
I understand you're from Venice, California,
yes,
which has been getting a lot of publicity lately.
VC.
What's so great about Venice?
Everything. The vibe, the people, the atmosphere, everything.
Venice Beach is where Los Angeles' true bohemian heart beats. It's an individualistic seaside oasis where self-expression and original thought are prized above all else. Venice gave the world Tina Marie.
I lived in Venice and near an area called Dogtown, where it's about seven blocks from California Avenue to Rose Avenue, where it's predominantly black. And I lived three blocks from there. So my friends in the community, I had a lot of, you know, different kind of friends. I had Mexican friends, African-American friends, black people. You know, it was just, Venice was like a melting pot. And it was just so multicultural that it was really just an awesome place to be from.
That's where she grew up. She went to Venice High. It was like five generations all in Venice. Her dad went to Venice, her mom went to Venice, her great-grandma went to Venice. Like, it goes all the way back. There's no racial barriers, you know what I'm saying? Like, everyone is just kicking it with everybody. You know, Venice Beach is, it's more than just a tourist attraction. It's where people come to just be who they are. I think that had a lot to do with who she was. She was special because she's the only one in her family that was kind of like that. You know, it was just her. She was the black sheep. And I think that was kind of a place for her to be who she was. You know, like, we are who we are before we are in our bodies. And I believe that she chose this life and that lifestyle to grow up in Venice and be that cool entity. And that was what she did. Right. You know, it was just a part of her.
Soul Train was in its early 70s prime and required viewing during Tina's high school years.
When I think about certain moments, like when I think about when I saw Al Green in Hot Pants on Soul Train, when he first come, I'm So Tired of Being Alone, that was really like an important moment for me, because that particular song kind of changed my life. I remember I was in the 10th grade and I was walking to English class, and I had a little transistor radio with a little earpiece in my, and that song came on. And that sound, we had not heard that kind of sound here in LA. You know, that it was a different sound. And I was like riveted, and I just stopped. And there was the whole hallway was just filled with people. And I stood back against the wall and I listened to the whole song, and it was so amazing and wonderful to me. And when the bell rang, I opened my eyes and everybody was in class and I was the only one standing in the hallway. And I had listened to the whole, I'm so tired of being alone. And then when I saw him perform it in Hot Pants on Soul Train, it was just like, this is just crazy. Just the whole like superstar thing. I mean, he was just so different.
To you, baby. You see, sometime I fool my arms, I say, ooh, whoa, oh, baby.
Hey.
Needing you has proven to me to be my greatest dream.
And that was the thing, you could just be different. You could be different. It was so many different people, you know, on there, and just so many personalities, and not just with the performers, as far as the musical performers, but the dancers and the hairstyles, and, you know, it's awesome. I think there's, people are always gonna feel that wonderful, like, kind of, like a comfort zone.
Up next, Tina waxes poetic about performing on Soul Train.
Gordy thought, he said, wow. He said, this music is so black. He said, I don't think we should put her picture on the cover. I think that we should just let the music speak on its own merit. The second album, when they did put my picture on the cover, the Lady T album, I've heard so many stories of people, like, you know, running to the store to get the album cover. And one particular story, a girl called her friend and was like, I came to buy this Tina Marie album and they made a mistake. And she was like, what do you mean they made a mistake? She was like, she's this really pretty white lady on there, but, you know, this is not Tina Marie. And she said they made a mistake. She was like, no, that's Tina Marie. She was like, no, Tina Marie is a chocolate woman with shells in her hair like Patrice Rushen.
Well, Tina Marie is one of the blackest white people ever. And Tina Marie's one interesting artist because I don't think there's... I wonder how many white people have bought her albums. Tina Marie is one of the blackest artists there is. Her audience, her crowd, if we go see her crowd right now, I would say it's probably 80% black. Black women. And black women tend not to like white women who are involved in black culture. There's always that little tension. They love Tina Marie. Tina Marie speaks from some place of... I don't understand how she does it. But she translates so well to the black American aesthetic. There's just something about this woman and her voice, her writing. She's a fantastic songwriter. She's a great arranger. She's a real, real serious musician. So Tina Marie is one of those examples to prove the rule, almost, that it's very hard for white artists to get credibility with black audiences. And she had it from album one. And she was all I see on Soul Train all the time. And it was never a moment where you felt, oh, what's this? Maybe the first time you saw Tina Marie, but after that it was a wrap.
It was really important because, like I said, there wasn't a lot of shows for us, you know? And, you know, my skin is white, but I'm not looked at like that, you know? I'm a black entertainer and always have been. And I'm very, very proud of my history and who I am. And so, you know, I didn't get played on a lot of white stations. You know, I only had one crossover record in my whole career. It's because of black people that I am who I am. You know, well, it's because of God first, because of the destiny that he had planned for me. But black people always embraced me and supported me as their own, and it was never looked at as a black or white thing. They just like, I love Tina, I love her music, you know? And black people just love good music, right?
It was so important to her to be embraced by the black community. I mean, she was embraced by the black community abundantly, but to be respected and to be noticed, you know, from the black community and from the black establishments like Soul Train and BT and the Grammys even, you know, it was important to her. And, you know, it's funny because she would say, you know, they're probably not going to give me any recognition until I'm gone.
What's your background, Tina? Where'd you begin your singing career?
Well, I was raised in Venice. All right. And I've been singing all my life, doing musicals and Smokey Robinson songs and just everything.
Yeah, you Smokey Robinson?
I'm a freak for Smokey Robinson.
Great. You had a small influence on you coming to Motown.
Quite a big influence.
The love of Smokey Robinson, she spoke of him all the time, and that was part of her structure of writing. She loved Smokey.
Well, Tina Marie, I've always teased her and told her that she was a black girl in a white body, you know. And because Tina is just so down to earth and so soulful and so, she is I don't know how to just put Tina, because Tina's, like I said, Tina's my little sister too. But Tina fits in everywhere she is. You know what I mean? But then again, when I think about when we were talking about the Motown family, we had a whole lot of white people at Motown. And nobody knew who, what color anybody was at Motown. You know what I mean? So, but Tina is just so personified. And she always has been.
I love the male vocal groups. You know, I love the Dells. And Smokey Robinson and the Miracles were my favorite. You know, he's just my favorite composer. And he's who I feel like I panned my whole career off of Smokey and how he wrote love songs. I studied his music, and that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to grow up to write beautiful love songs like Smokey. And all my friends called me Lil Smokey. I would take my guitar to the parties, and I would sing all the Smokey Robinsons. I know every Smokey Robinson song. And I was Lil Smokey because I had the same range, and I could sing all his songs just like him. You know, I was already like a legend in my own little town, you know, and the notorious Lady T. I had a lot of nicknames, you know, my friends called me Shorty, Lil Bit. And the bond that we had, me and the sisters, was that I could sing and I was an athlete and they were athletes, you know, and then we all love music. So I would take my little turntable, and it was battery powered, and all the little 45s that I had, the Miracles, you know, all Smokey stuff. And I'd sit out on the field because I ran track. And we'd play music and we'd run track. You know, we would try to beat each other's records. And, you know, they would look at me and they'd go, sing that Brendan the Tabulations record, you know? So later on, like by the time that, like, I think my first record came out in 79 and I graduated from high school in 74. So a few years later, it was like, Tina's on Soul Train, you know? And it was like, you know, a local, our homegirl made it, you know? And everybody was like, yeah, you know, Venice is on. Crazy, and I mean, I've been on there so many times. I think I'm on like 9, 10, 11 episodes or something, you know, with Rick, by myself, Ronnie McNair. It was just exciting to me because, you know, that's kind of what we had, you know, when we were kids, and that's kind of how we all bonded, because there wasn't a lot of shows like that, you know, there wasn't a lot of shows like that for black people, you know, and it was so exciting just to be a part of that, you know, and I never really imagined, like I said, that I would grow up to, you know, perform on the same stage with the Whispers or, you know, like I loved Al Green, you know. It was a dream, but, you know, we dream when we're kids, you know, and we hope that our dreams come true, but they don't always, you know. So I was really, really excited, you know, just to be on TV and have my, you know, people's loving my music, and it was just amazing to me. I was like, this is crazy. I'm like a young girl from Venice that, you know, is crazy.
I saw her on Soul Train, and then next thing you know, I'm playing for her, you know, and I'm excited about that. And wow, it's one of those things that you look on in your career like, oh, I kind of like made it a statement in some kind of capacity, you know, because she was a legend within herself, you know, being a little kid, watching her on Soul Train, then being an adult and now playing for her, you know, through the last of her career. So that was an honor.
Every time we got on stage, everybody would come to life. It was electrifying.
One of Tina's true joys in life, besides singing and performing, was her daughter, Aaliyah Rose. A gifted singer in her own right, she often toured and shared the stage with her mother.
When she would get in LA, it was like her mode. It was like her city. Nobody could tell her nothing. She would just shut it down and crip walk and do this little African dance that she would do. She did so much, and she ran across that stage like she was a teenager every single time. I didn't understand it. You know, I'm watching her like, damn, she moves around better than me. You know, she was jumping and hopping and spinning and hitting them all the notes and doing the most. That was her place that she loved to be more than I think anywhere was the stage.
Stay tuned. Tina speaks on her best friend and musical soulmate, Rick
Tina
James.
Performances on Soul Train. The one that comes to mind first, I just saw like a few days ago. She had on this like, I want to say cashmere kind of sweater with like a V type of pattern, or I don't know if it was somewhat off the shoulders, and her hair was like wavy and not too big, but 80s big, mid 80s big. And she just had that step, right? But, you know, it's funny because when I worked with her in the studio, like, I always tell this story when I talk about recording the song. Her and her best friend, they cha-cha'd the entire session. Like, once I was in the booth, all I saw was them two, like, dancing around the room. So now when I watch that performance, I'm, like, thinking of Tina cha-cha, but she always had a little step in her, you know?
Energy on the stage was just unbelievable. She always changes up and surprises us. Her energy is just explosive.
Get on the mark there, Lady T. You tired?
No.
Huh?
You want me to do it again?
How long could you do that?
About an hour.
Seemed like such an innocent little girl.
All I know was I was on Soul Train and I was a star. And I was excited. They were playing me on the radio. I was on Soul Train and it was like, okay, I'm kind of like, I was bona fide, you know? It was, you know, I've been singing all my life since I was 8 years old. I was singing professionally from the time I was 8 years old. You know what I'm saying? But it's a different thing, you know, when you're on TV, you know? So everybody's calling on the phone. Tina's on Soul Train. You know, what? Tina's on Soul Train, you know? And Michael, I think it had a lot to do with me, you know, blowing up. You know, that's what we had. We had Soul Train.
One of the most significant associations and influences on Tina's career and life was an artist whose name hers would always be associated with. Maverick punk funk superstar, Rick James.
Rick and Tina.
Hey, how you doing?
How did all this get started, you and Rick?
I met Rick in the hallway at Motown one day about a year and a half ago, and he heard me sing.
Was he looking wild and crazy?
A little bit, not too much.
He heard you sing where?
He heard me at Motown.
Uh-huh. And he volunteered to...
To produce my album.
Get involved. Did you know what punk funk was at the time?
No, at that time, Rick's first album, Come Get It, wasn't even out.
I never really, really was attracted to Rick at first. We were best friends. And then one day, this is funny, I've never told this story. One day we were in a big soundstage, like right now. And he was performing a song that he did called Love Gun. And he was, I love gun, I got my bang, bang, bang. And I was sitting with my best friend, Mickey, and I just stopped. And I looked at her and I went, I think I'm in love with him. And she was like, huh? Who, Rick? You know, because we'd been friends for 3.5 years. I was like, yeah, it's Love Gun. I got my bang, bang, bang. This is crazy.
I don't even understand how they were together. Knowing them older and thinking of them as being younger, I don't know how it worked.
And we ended up dating. We knew we never should have. You know, we never should have, but it was probably really good for the music. Rick was amazing. He was a character. I miss him so much. He was my best friend more than anything. I mean, we were together for not even a year because we just, you know, both of us were arrogant. And we were best friends before we dated. And, you know, everything that I saw him do before we were together, he tried to do to me once we got together. And I was like, wait a minute. You taught me you can't do this with me. That's not going to work. So we ended up, you know, just always keeping our friendship. And more than anything, he was like my brother.
I was Tina Marie and Rick James drummer. I started with Rick first. I met Tina in the process of working with Rick. And actually had an opportunity to work with both of them at the same time. Fire and Desire. All I can say is they have this kind of chemistry that's like unreal. You know, you hear the little stories how two people can write, well, one person can write a song, but it seemed like both of them wrote it. You know, he wrote the song, but of course, when they sung it together, you thought they were still in love. You thought they'd been in love for years. They knew what it was all about to be in love and that it carried through in the music.
Me and Tasman, which is Rick's son, we grew up mimicking them. You know, every time they would get on stage, we would do our thing on the sidelines. Watching them perform it, because I did get to see them perform it, it was something else. You know, their chemistry was off the chain. It really was. It's like you can only hope for something with like that with someone. You know what I'm saying? And they had that. They were musical soulmates. And being an artist, you look for that. You search for that your whole life and hope to find it one day.
Probably us getting together was probably really, really important and magical for Fire and Desire. After Rick passed away, it was really hard for me to sing that song because I knew he just couldn't walk out on stage anytime anymore, because we would just show up to each other's shows and we would never tell each other when we were coming. We would just show up and somebody would hand me a mic or would hand him a mic depending upon whose show it was. And, you know, we would just surprise each other and you know, that can't happen anymore. So I took it out of the show for a while. That was like, I can't take it out. I said, because it's just so important to so many people's lives.
Wow. It's really good to see you again, baby.
It's good to see you too, baby.
And I must admit, you look very them and leave them.
Yes.
That's what I used to do.
Sing a song.
I used to use and abuse them, baby. And then I laid eyes on you.
Was playing
strictly
simple pleasure.
Well, do you know? Do you feel
that was my claim to fame?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
When every single man.
What did we do, baby? What did we do, baby?
Your teardrop stains.
Next up, Layla Hathaway, Faith Evans, and Shaunice Wilson reminisce on their friendship with Tina Marie.
Tina is a huge chunk of rhythm and blues music. She is a huge chunk of what we see today when we look at Alicia Keys or Missy Elliott or Mariah Carey. Tina was that in 1979. Tina was producing, she was playing instruments, she was arranging, she was singing, she was doing backup, she was arranging vocals. She is this huge force of music that people don't even realize when they hear the influence, they don't even know where it's coming from.
Tina, I understand you're about to embark on your second album produced by Tina.
That's right, I start tomorrow.
And written by Tina.
Right.
Arranged by Tina?
Arranged, production, everything.
Everything.
To know her as an artist, first and foremost, I used to pore through my mom's album covers and look at the pictures and read the credits. And funny enough, my mom had like all of Tina's albums up until that time. I'm talking early 80s. So it's funny because in my mind, she was always someone that I just admired because I saw her name on the back in the credits, not only her face on the front.
Tina was really a poet. And everything about her musical presentation was this thick, lush poetry. It was the strings, the guitars, the bass, the percussion. I mean, even down to her arranging herself every song in the beginning saying, "Wee!" You know, it was a presentation. And that's how we used to, that's how we used to get down in R&B music.
That sort of challenge you, that you kind of shoot at?
Well, I hate to look at it as challenging another, you know, lady. I believe that all the ladies in the world that have talent should stand up for their talent.
But, does that mean
I love Aretha Franklin. Oh. Aretha Franklin is like my ultimate. Sarah Vaughan is the ultimate performer to me.
Shortly after Tina's passing, a group of friends, family, and bandmates held a special tribute performance in her honor. Here's spoken word artist and close friend, Sonya Marie.
She blew me away from the moment I met her. I mean, of course, we all know her music, but to look in her eyes and know her spirit is a whole nother thing.
At 12, I kissed this perfect stranger, iambically injecting stanzas. She emoted permission to wail in my decisions. To love some boy made me tame that groove so violent she abused me. Draping melodies between scented sheets, I shake my woman with her songs deep, dared my sweet poetic destiny.
Tina Marie's legacy is, it's obvious and mysterious all at the same time. I believe she was a woman that did more than cross color lines with her music. She invited spirit. She invited a universal note and song and word to touch the hearts of people.
It ain't over. Remember my name. It ain't over. Remember her name. I love you, T.
I used to go to Tina's house. She would barbecue. She would make all sorts of things, like lasagna and greens. Things that don't necessarily go together, but she cooked them really well. We hang out by the pool, barbecue, listen to music. Last time I went over there, she had a good Chicago mix with Earth, Wind & Fire and The Emotions and just hanging out.
This is one of my favorite Chicago double dutch, roller skating, singing with a brush, tennis racket, my spandex pants with a towel on my head, with a bobby pin, Tina Marie hits.
As a singer, Tina stands alone. Tina has that voice that can immediately transport you back to wherever you were when you listened to it, just like any great voice or instrument can. When I sang at her tribute, it immediately takes me to roller skating at the Rainbow Roller Rink. It immediately takes me to Chicago in 1982 to being in the back of my mother's car
to having my Walkman, which was the size of my mother's car, having Tina on that Walkman, those songs take you back to that time. So her voice is a distinct voice. It really stands alone. There's no other voice like Tina.
I don't want you fire without your flame.
Never tried to follow the trends of what everybody else was doing, you know. I was blessed to work with Tina when I was 11 years old. And she asked me during our last conversation if she could adopt me and if she could be my auntie. So she'll forever be my Aunt Tina. I love her so much.
Well, the very first time I met Tina was at Venice Beach. She was roller skating, and I was a huge fan as a little girl, so I knew, wow, that's Tina Marie, you know. But I actually got to work with her when I was 11 years old. I just remember being very excited. I remember being really nervous because I'm like, this is the legendary Tina Marie, so, and I was only a little kid, so.
I feel like I've been on this earth many times before. Once I was a white gazelle on horseback riding free, searching in the darkness for a piece of me. And I can feel this for sure. I've been here before. I can feel this for sure, for sure, for sure, for sure, for sure. I've been here before. Yeah. Queen, you know, on an island by the sea, with rainbow-colored people, happy as can be. They never had a problem. They never had a care. Love was never flowing, and this feeling shared.
Tina was before her time. Her songs will be around forever. Like, you can listen to Portuguese Love and
and all her songs in it, it sounds like she just recorded them yesterday, you know. So her music's timeless.
I think God had an amazing destiny for me, and I think that he put whoever's in me, you know, the soul that's in me, because everybody has a beautiful soul. It's all different, you know, and I think that everyone should be allowed to sing whatever they is, you know, whatever their soul reflects, you know. I just happened to love what I loved. And, you know, it's funny to me because, you know, it's like you look at Minnie Riperton, right? You look at Aretha, you know, obviously two different souls, both beautiful spirits. A lot of people thought Minnie was white, you know, because she didn't have that kind of soul per se. You know what I'm saying? But she had her own soul. Some of the greatest opera singers in the world have been African-American women. You know what I'm saying? So what, they're not supposed to sing opera because they're African-American? You reflect what it is that God gives you. And I think that that he really, really made me the way he made me just to bring people closer together, you know, to see that. You know, now we have a black president. You know what I'm saying? Maybe I was a part of that. That's how I look at it. You know, I don't, and if it opened any doors for anyone, you know, I'm happy that people are just able to express themselves.
December 26th, 2010, saw the passing of one of the world's most unique R&B performers. Tina Marie was synonymous with artistry and beautiful spirit.
She never really compared herself to anyone. She stood on her own, and she knew where she stood. And for her to compare herself to other legends, it doesn't really make sense.
We lost her, and we know, you know, it's like a sort of a blunt force trauma. But I think in the same way as, you know, like when my daddy left, it's gonna be years to come, we're gonna say, oh, wow. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. We're gonna reinterpret her music and reinterpret her contribution to soul music and music in general. And we're going to continue to reinterpret her loss.
She will be just so missed and loved by people like myself who did get a chance to experience the person. But for those that didn't, please just learn a lesson from the path that she laid. Do your history. And again, I love you, Tina. May you rest in peace always.
Tina Marie is... I see her like with like Prince and the, you know, James Brown. Like, she has so much soul.
She was the coolest mom that you could ever have. You know, she took me everywhere with her. It was only me and her, you know, growing up. You know, I'm closer to my dad now, but back then it was just mommy and baby. She had a hard time watching me grow up, and the day that she passed was the day I had to. And I really just had to step up to the plate. You know what I'm saying? I've been the wild child. I've done all of that. And now it's time to be a woman and you know, be who she wanted me to be. And I'm actually looking forward to seeing the person that I've become through all of it.
We spend a lot of time in this park with our kids. We do garage sales on the weekends, you know. We come down here and hang out with the kids and ride the paddle boats together, and leave from here and go play miniature golf. You know, we spend a lot of time away from the studio. We spend a lot of time together as family, you know. And she is missed, man.
I think that she knew that she was gonna go, for example. And because I do know that, it makes it that much easier. You know what I'm saying? She talked about it. So I kind of knew that this day was gonna come eventually. I just didn't think it was gonna come this soon. I love you. I miss you. And I know you're watching. And watch what I'm gonna do with this, mama. Just watch.
It is a beautiful thing. I've had a wonderful life, thank you.